So, hi, nice to see everyone. I'm Sarah Davidson. I'm a clinical psychologist at the Resettle Project, which we're going to talk to you a little bit about today.
I'm Vicky Baker, another clinical psychologist at the Resettle Project, and it's fair to say that our colleagues from probation aren't here today, because I guess this is a psychology gig, but this is very much a partnership project that we're about to present, and that's a very important part of what we do, because we very much believe in sort of managing risk in a therapeutic way.
So, exercise coordination. So just a few aims for you for today. We're going to talk a little bit about the project, kind of who we are, a history of the service and something called the Offender Personality Disorder Pathway, which some of you might be familiar with, some of you may not. Some key principles for the model that we use, really, and just a thank you to Karen for the previous presentation, which has really set up nicely a wonderful overview to cognitive and analytic therapy, which is some of the ways that we try and work relationally with the guys in our service. So we'll talk a little bit about that and some of the challenges of the work, really. In terms of kind of why beyond the therapy room, I was lucky enough to be part of the kind of original team. I had a small role in organising our original Beyond the Therapy Room conference in 2015. And I remember thinking at the time that this was a service that I was about to join that would just fit so wonderfully with a lot of the principles that Beyond the Therapy Room hold so closely to their hearts, really. So it's really pride-inducing for me today to stand here in Liverpool and everything that Liverpool kind of represents, talking about a service that I feel so strongly about, really, at a conference that I feel so strongly about as well. So it's lovely to be here with you today. So Resettle, we'll talk a little bit more about each of these factors, but basically we are a jointly funded NHS and NOMS probation service, and we are one small part of what's called the Offender Personality Disorder Pathway, which Vicky will talk to you a little bit more about in a minute. But we are a service predominantly for, we're male only, for men coming out of prison with complex difficulties, psychological difficulties, social difficulties, that is seen to link to their personality functioning and to their offending. So the guys are at high risk of reoffending, and they attend our project as part of their license conditions for between 18 months and 2 years on their release from prison. So at its heart, really, Resettle is about balancing risk management with therapeutic intervention, which is a balance that we'll talk lots to you through the process of today.
Okay, so we were originally funded via the Dangerous and Severe Personality Disorder provision, which was a partnership between the Ministry of Justice and Department of Health. And it was really a recognition that, as is often the case, we invest heavily in sort of dramatic interventions, but don't necessarily plan for sort of what happens when people leave. So that was very much focused on the high secure hospitals and prisons. But actually, there haven't been much attention paid to what happens when people come out, and in fact, people are getting stuck in the high secure estate. And I guess there was also recognition that we're working with men coming out of prison after long sentences who've committed very serious offences and remain at high risk of committing offences on release. And there was recognition it doesn't matter how good your intervention is within a high secure environment. What you need to do is test out risk in the community. And also all the problems with kind of removing people from their communities and their relationships compound often the risk. So something about pathways out of prisons and high secure hospitals. But also recognition that there's a lot of social and psychological origins to offending. We've talked a lot about disadvantage, the impact of trauma. And my personal history was I started off as a probation officer and then retrained as a clinical psychologist. And I guess I was aware of a lot of kind of distress manifesting offending whilst I was a probation officer, but felt really out of my depth about how to work with that. And then actually having retrained as a clinical psychologist and working in mainstream mental health provision, the people I'd worked with previously didn't come anywhere near our therapy services. So something about applying those psychological skills within the criminal justice system felt very important, and that was very much part of the Resettle brief that we were working in partnership with probation, very much where these people were, which was in the criminal justice system, but applying our psychological skills within that setting. So this this is a poem that one of our participants, as we call them, wrote for an arts project that we did, and I think it kind of sums up really what we've just said about the sort of social and psychological difficulties that come from very, very difficult early histories. I think I'm going to have to read it out, unfortunately, because I'm not sure you can see it at the back. Is that okay? So, 57 homes, it makes my head hurt. Rice Lane Foster Home made me worse. Croxteth Children's Home, here we come. Strangers look after you, no dad or mum. Care homes made me mad. Moved around because I was bad. Waking up in a room I didn't know. This was a child at an all-time low. So... so I think that speaks for itself, really. And this slide actually comes from the Ministry of Justice's own work around the factors that are associated with reoffending. And again, we've rehearsed a lot of these already this morning in terms of substance misuse, kind of impulsivity. Social networks are often, and lack of any social networks, as Karen articulated very well, I think, either a lack of or poor family and intimate relationships. Lack of opportunity generally, and I think particularly an absence of hope. And I guess what we know is if we remove people from their communities and stigmatise them and put them in prisons where they don't have any opportunity to pursue family relationships or be socially integrated, it perpetuates these very problems. So I guess, you know, there's something a bit sort of mad really about kind of investing all this money in the prison estate that, as we all know, is in crisis. And where actually to survive you have to be sort of defended and look after your own and not necessarily connect with others. So it feels ironic that, you know, that what we do is we compound the very difficulties that lead to offending in the first place. So I guess one of the positive things about our project and the context within we work, the policy context, is that it's saying, well, actually maybe prison is not the best option, we need to look at alternatives.
Okay, so just to kind of back up a little bit about what Vicky was saying there, if you look at some of the statistics in terms of links between offending and social adversity, and thinking, I've already been struck this morning by some of the similarities in the talks that we've heard about what we're really getting at here at Beyond the Therapy Room in looking at some of the kind of socio-political context that we find ourselves now in services. So in terms of some of the statistics that apply to the people that we work with, prisoners are 13 more times more likely to have been in care as a child, 10 times more likely to have been a regular truant from school, they're 13 times more likely to be unemployed, they're 2.5 times more likely to have a family member who's been convicted of a criminal offence. So when you're thinking about attachment and generational impact of attachment, that's a real big one for us. And they're 6 times more likely to have been a young father and all the kind of things that go with that. So, I mean, I guess the reason that we've put this slide in is really just to start to highlight and humanise a little bit a service user group that are quite often very marginalised. They're not looked at compassionately, either politically or sometimes by the general public, and certainly within services. And yet, actually, you could probably apply some of those statistics similarly to a lot of the other service user groups that we'll be talking about today. And it just makes you think, really, we're all pretty similar when it comes down to it.
Okay, so as I say, we predated the offender personality disorder pathway, which sort of superseded the dangerous and severe personality disorder provision. And I definitely see this as a very positive thing for a number of reasons. I mean, it's a highly problematic title. There's lots of debate about the, you know, how difficult and inaccurate and unhelpful PD diagnosis is, nor valid. And also, it's important to say it's disproportionately associated with risk and challenging behaviour, because most people don't get diagnosed with personality disorder. I'm not advocating that they should, but I guess people only have the assessment if they're causing problems within the system. I mean, as we all know, quoted prevalence rates vary hugely, but it's usually accepted between 5 and 10% of the general population probably would meet the criteria for at least one personality disorder. And around 60 to 70% of the prison population. So it's a kind of so what, really. You know, I guess what we know from that is a lot of people manage okay, even though they might meet the criteria. Some people don't. a lot of people in the prison system have those sorts of relational difficulties, no big surprise there. So one of the positives about the pathway, despite its name, is that it very much de-emphasises diagnosis. And it's very much about seeing the individual, kind of an understanding of the individual and a very tailored intervention for that individual, which is very much what we do at Resettle. And also recognition of the origins of offending and personalised disorder in terms of, you know, childhood adversity and ongoing difficulties. So it's very much a relational approach, looking at the environment created by services. So Karen mentioned psychologically informed environments in hostels. We have part of the pathway is about psychologically informed planned environments, which is another little kind of branding exercise, really. As we all know, there's lots of different acronyms that name essentially the same thing, but within the pathway they're called PIPES. Very much sort of it, recognising the need for innovation, and also that recognising that you need services that pay attention to social and psychological difficulties, so very much psychologically underpinned interventions, and really saying psychologists have a duty to work where these people are, which is within the criminal justice system, and that is not doing therapy. And as Sarah says, actually it's great, you know, some of us have been saying this for years, that we, you know, it's not about hard to reach, it's about we need to get ourselves, it's us that's the problem, not the people we're talking about. And I think, you know, what's now being recognised within the pathway is that a lot of the people within the pathway would not tolerate therapy for the reasons that Karen articulated. So actually we need to be creative about how we apply our psychological skills with this population.
Okay, so Vicky's talked about some of these already, but in terms of positives about the OPD pathway, there is very much a kind of real de-emphasis on diagnosis. So for ourselves as a service, we don't use diagnostic labels, we don't use diagnostic terminologies. Part of doing formulation work is that everybody's needs are understood within a formulation framework. Within the pathway more generally, there is a focus on environmental intervention. I know we've got some OPD pathway guys in today. Along the pathway generally, there is very much this focus on kind of making your environment more psychologically minded and a recognition of the need for real innovation and partnership working. So a bit like some of the other people that we've heard from today already, there is a real need to do something different, because what we know for offenders quite often for lots of different reasons is that the services we've developed traditionally just don't work. There is a focus on psychologically informed services, obviously, and for staff, and I think that's a really important part of it, is that workforce development and staff support and supervision is as crucial to the OPD pathway as the services are for the offenders themselves. And I think that is partly a recognition of the need for relational working, but also a recognition that this work can be demanding, and if you don't support and supervise and kind of just recognise your staff adequately, then they won't be able to do a good job, which means our service users won't get adequate provision. And there's a real emphasis on continuity from community to community. So in terms of gatekeeping, in terms of working with other agencies, there's an idea that offenders, particularly those who are deemed as high risk, that they could quite frequently get stuck in the system because people are very risk averse and want to get them into services, but then they don't really plan a pathway out for them. And so that word that's been used a lot today already about hope, quite a lot of our guys come to us from a position where they've had very little hope. A real focus on well-being and social integration as well as offending behaviour. So we do look at offending behaviour, we very much don't gloss over that or kind of ignore it, but there is an emphasis that to be well-rounded individuals we need a lot more than just to look at one facet of our lives, really. So this is just a little slide, again, as Vicky said, when they last did an art project in the project, what personality disorder, in very much in inverted commas, means to participants. So personality disorder, when I first heard it, I thought, I'm not a fucking fraggle, there's nothing wrong with me. And then, wow, that was up and down. One minute you smile, next minute you frown. That's just my personality disorder hanging around. P.S. I ain't lost the plot. So I think when we were planning these slides, we were saying there's a real recognition here, even just in the scope of one slide, that whilst people really respond, quite understandably in my mind, quite negatively to being labelled, there is some acknowledgement that that there's patterns in their lives that have been repeated that perhaps aren't helpful, that there are high levels of distress being experienced, both for them and for other people. So it's a need to do something, but certainly not within this kind of traditional scope of PD. So a little bit more about us then. So we were originally called an IRMS model, which is lovely, an Intensive Intervention Risk Management Service. We now just stick with Resettle. But just to say that IRMS model is being rolled out at various other services across the country now. So people, which is really lovely, people do come to our service and say, we'd like to roll out something similar. Can we speak to you about how you did that? And to say I've only been involved in the project for 18 months, but Vicky's been involved in it since its inception, which is 10 years ago. And we were originally a pilot project, but we are now continually funded. And whilst I guess we're all working in services where we have to sit with that kind of uncertainty about funding, it seems that our kind of commissioners are positive and want to fund us into the long term, which is really lovely. So we are a high intensity project. Our service users are with us 4 days a week for most of the day. We are non-residential, but we do work very closely with probation hostels in the area and accommodation providers. So in terms of what happens, people will come to us from prison, they will stay in a probation approved premises for the first 12 weeks, and then we work really intensively with other agencies to make sure they have some sort of accommodation for them at the end of that, because I guess, just like Karen was talking about earlier, homelessness for this population is a really huge problem, and we can't expect people to make, you know, gains in terms of making changes in their lives if they don't have a secure base to start from. So we're very proud to say we're a psychology-led service. There is a real emphasis on departure from a medical model. That's not to say, I'm very aware that the DCP conference has been going on this week and there's been lots of talk about power and how we use power as psychologists. I think it's important to say that we don't take this as an opportunity to kind of implement another kind of dogma on people who might have had that their whole lives. It's just an opportunity for them to hopefully reconceptualise some of the things that have happened to them and some of the things that they may have done to other people in a slightly more compassionate way. But that we use psychology both with the service users and with staff. So we're a multi-agency team. We have, as Vicky said, we're half funded by NHS England and half funded by NOMS, but within that we have a range of different disciplines. So we have psychologists, people who've been drug workers, people who've been social workers, offender managers, support workers. So we're getting the benefit of lots of expertise, really. And we're very much a three-stage model. So we do a lot of focus in terms of building relationships for at least 6 months before somebody is due to be released to us, to really start to forge some of those positive attachments that quite often people have just never had experience of before, certainly within the criminal justice system. And then there's this tendency of the project, and then we're very much involved with kind of moving people on to kind of make those transitions back into the community. And I should say, I'll talk about a case at the end, but I should say, just to give you some context of that, some of our service users might have been in prison for up to kind of 25 plus years at the time that they come to us. So this world outside is completely alien to them in terms of reintegrating them. So we are very much an attachment-based enabling environment. We offer both group and individual interventions, and our overarching model is sociotherapy, which I think fits really well in terms of Beyond the Therapy Room principles, because what that model says really is that you don't need to be sat doing one-to-one intensive therapy with someone. This model's very much about relationships, and what it says is that basically any interaction that you have over the day with a service user and with one another is an opportunity for a therapeutic incident to take place. So that goes from having community meetings together, cooking together in the community, eating together, going on social activities, to formulation sessions, to doing consultations with staff. So it's, at its heart, it's relationships and kind of building those over time. So we have some key principles. Again, a little bit like Karen was talking about before, we have clear and high expectations of behaviour, really. I think, to be fair, we ask a lot of our service users, but with that, we afford them respects, and we recognise and work with the fact that at times it's really difficult for people, both in terms of their offending, but just in terms of their personality functioning generally, and how hard relationships are. and it's difficult for us sometimes, I think that's fair to say. It's not just on the part of the guys. So there's a real focus on engagement, fostering and maintaining a therapeutic alliance. We couldn't do the rest of the work that we do if we didn't have those core relationships formed. So we spend an awful lot of time attending to that. And it works, I think it's fair to say, most of the time. So we are, I think one of the things we were mindful of when we were putting this together was to emphasise, and maybe that's some of our anxiety, that we are very much a kind of robust risk management service. We're not kind of the, I think sometimes maybe people see us as the fluffy alternative option. We're not that. We're just a little bit more balanced in terms of being compassionate and understanding offending in a way that might be slightly different from traditional services. So we're very transparent with service users and with our kind of commissioners and our stakeholders that risk management is really key to us, and we do make difficult decisions when we need to, we do recall when we need to, but that is alongside a context of therapy and real intensive support. And difficulties are noticed and explored from a kind of curious standpoint as opposed to a very withholding, punitive, authoritative standpoint, which is something that I think most of our guys will have experienced in the criminal justice system. So some other bits of our model. We have a 24-hour, so an out of eyes crisis line, which we all take it in terms to man over weekends and out of core office hours. And we've put that in inverted commas because I think what's really highlighted to us is that our understanding of crisis can be quite different from what somebody else's understanding of crisis is, and really that doesn't matter. It's whatever that person's understanding of crisis is at that time. And what we know from some of the data that we've had fed back from people who use the crisis line is that quite often that's been really pivotal in kind of preventing a recall or preventing someone from really deteriorating, that they've been able to have that support. So again, we use targeted interventions, so we have a range of groups that are running at any time. We have a group that kind of focuses on what it means to be a man, so a kind of masculinity-focused group and all the problems that that can raise for people. We have emotional regulation groups, all kinds of different things. And in terms of individual work, a big part of my role is doing kind of a 5-session CAT formulation with people. So we're not doing the one-to-one therapy, but we are providing them with a framework of understanding. And as Karen's really helpfully talked about this morning, we're guided by kind of CAT-informed formulations. So that's led by me. But that we do that kind of upstairs and downstairs. I do that from a consultation point of view with staff, but also with the guys downstairs. And I think from the beyond the therapy room perspective, there's a real focus on kind of social integration, high levels of support, education, employment benefits. I'm really getting this sense of people who've been incredibly disenfranchised and marginalised in the community, encouraging them to kind of tentatively step back into that community a little bit, but also give something back to the people they might have offended against. Just whiz through this really quickly. So that's the relational approach that Karen outlined earlier. I won't go over that again, but I think just in terms of the aware for need of sensitivity about boundaries and awareness of how we might use power, I think that's really important. And just in terms of how we might think about offending with some of the guys, this is kind of another way in which you might use reciprocal roles in CAP. And just, again, as Vicky said earlier, just getting over this understanding that quite often offending is a manifestation of trauma and distress. And whilst that's not about lacking response, taking responsibility in regards to offending, it is maybe conceptualising it in a slightly different way, that if you've been traumatised or abused or neglected, then you might act out in a way that is traumatising and abusing. And that's kind of just an illustration that what we aspire to be really at our heart is a secure base, and a secure base that a lot of our guys will never ever have experienced before, that they'll have come from really very traumatic backgrounds, and that will have been kind of re-emphasised and reinforced throughout their lifetime, so that we eventually hope that they feel secure enough to become more independent and venture off into the world themselves. So in terms of supporting the team, very similar to what Karen was saying, we're encouraging curiosity, so thinking about behaviours and presentations in a slightly different way, resisting the temptation to engage in the dance again, which we like that phrase in Cats, and noticing kind of the pull, so maintaining the seesaw. I use the Hamilton's boundary seesaw model a lot with the staff, which seems to really illustrate well some of the things that we get pulled into.
Okay, so some of the challenges, and again, it very much fits with what people have said before about a lot of what is important, I think, is managing expectations, both our expectations of ourselves, the men's expectations of themselves and of us, and the wider system's expectations. And especially when you're a pilot, I think it's very tempting to kind of overpromise. But I guess we were very fortunate because we were a pilot and have a very good relationship with our commissioners, and there's a real commitment to innovation that we were all going into this quite realistically about. We were taking very complex, risky men and trying to manage them in the community. It was completely uncharted. We didn't know whether we could manage the risk effectively, although, as Sarah said, they're all subject to post-custody release licences, so we can and do recall them to prison. And we sort of knew that that was a bit of a bottom line, that we had to kind of prove ourselves in terms of risk management. But also, we didn't know whether we could engage these men. A lot of them spend a lot of their sentence on segregation units. So actually, I think that's a key part of our success, actually, that we've managed to develop relationships with them, and they'll ask us for help. And I think this point about their ambivalence about seeking and receiving help. But as I said before, in a prison environment, if you show your vulnerability, that's a very risky thing to do. And we did a consultation exercise with some of our men because we were looking at accommodation needs. And they told us some probably not unexpected things, but very powerful things about, you know, I'm a 50-year-old man. I've learned to survive in the prison system by being the tough guy on the wing. It's hard to admit that I don't know how to budget and I don't know how to feed myself. I need to know someone and trust them before I'll say that and before I'll accept help. And it's kind of obvious, isn't it? And yet what we do is we have these sort of people, you know, like support workers who they've never met before, who are genuinely wanting to offer help. But it's very hard to receive help, actually. So you need to kind of offer it within a relationship. You know, as we get pulled into this desire for a quick fix, this is very slow and steady work. But actually a really nice example from this week, talking about the crisis line, is a few of us came to one of the fringe events this week, and a couple of our guys were going to come with us, and in the event one of them came. And we basically said, oh, we'll meet you at the venue, because we, you know, they were able to get themselves there. But actually one of them got lost on the way, as did I, in fact. But he phoned our crisis line, and one of our members of staff, who, bearing in mind he'd been at work all day and is taking this call, you know, he's got young children, is there, and he basically directed our participant to the venue on the crisis line. And as Sarah says, that's not a crisis, and yet in terms of enabling him to get to a venue, but we didn't want to kind of go and pick him up because it felt like it was important for him to kind of start independently. But that felt like a really appropriate use of the crisis line, actually. But yes, I think there's, you know, it's fair to say these are very risky people that we're working with. We've very much proved ourselves as safe pairs of hands. But, you know, we have to be realistic and not shy away from the risk management element of our work, but also not be too anxious and too reactive. But also maintaining hope and maintaining relationships during a period of recall. I think this is a real key part of our model, actually, that when we do recall people to prison, we don't give up on them. And often, when people finish with us, we have a community meeting where we'll reflect on their time in the project. And a key theme, and this is another thing they told us, it's about we stick with them, we don't give up on them. But equally, they don't give up on us. You know, we survive difficulties. And just finally, this is a very old quote from Jimmy Boyle, but we rather liked it because I think it's a reminder of the enormity of the task for the people we're working with. That often they've truanted from school from an early age, and to be quite honest, the schools have probably breathed a sigh of relief when they haven't turned up. You know, they're in a prison environment where nobody really, what they don't want to be there, nobody wants them to be there. You know, that sense of sort of being invisible. And often, you know, they've got some benefits from offending. So there's something about giving them an alternative place where they can feel sort of validated and welcomed, and we notice them and we actually care whether they turn up, is really important. So I think this quote kind of sums that up, about I'm finding out a great deal about myself. I'm making new relationships and living in a world totally unknown to me. I love it, yet there are times when I hate it. I'm torn between two worlds, alienated from the old one, and a stranger in this new one.
This is just quite human, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
And I think at its heart.
Yeah. Okay. So that's
I guess just to kind of give some context to that, I know we're out of time, it'll be really quick. In terms of outcomes, we do recall people who eventually get to the end of the to the end of their license. But I suppose just in terms of a couple of quick success stories, 2 weeks ago, a guy finished with us, so completed his 18 months, 2 years actually, because he was under the old system, wasn't he, period with us, having gone into prison on his 19th birthday for a very serious violent offence and spending 28 years in prison. So that wasn't just because of us, he did a lot of work with other services within the pathway. But in terms of kind of thinking about the enormity of that on somebody's life, I think that's really quite powerful to think of. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Time for one or two questions, if anyone has anything else.
Is there any way of being done with women's prisons as well, or is it just male?
Sorry, so the question was there any kind of work being done in women's prisons? In terms of a service like this, not at the moment, but in terms of other parts of the pathway, there are slowly starting kind of a recognition that women have very different kinds of offending needs, but that something similar that really works from a more relational point of view needs to be put in place. So there's a lot of work that goes on at Stile Prison, particularly, that's starting to work kind of in a more psychologically informed way. And I think there are a couple of OPD community projects, aren't they, down south?
There's one in Leeds. So I guess there are fewer women who would meet the criteria in terms of risk and, well, risk mainly. And it is recognised that their needs are different and how they get kind of treated within the criminal justice system. But there are some services both within prisons and in the community. As I say, there's an IRMS, like a day drop-in service in Leeds.
There's Tomorrow's Women, isn't there? There's organisations that do it.
Yeah.
Yours seems really good and joined up more. I just wondered if there was going to be a parallel process for women.
It would be lovely, wouldn't it?
Well, I think so, because for women, a lot of them are caregivers of children as well, and I think it's them that you've got to think about, so there's a lot to benefit from women as well. And I think what you're doing is excellent, and I just feel awake and set up.
Right.
I'm a therapist and stuff, but I think it needs to be replicated in...
I know one of the difficulties that people have is when they come for consultation about our IRMS model, quite often what they're trying to do is replicate it, but slightly toned down, or slightly, do you call it IRMS light? Mm. And I think one of the reasons it works for resettle is because we've been very lucky up to now in terms of our commission, and people see the value of every single factor of it, because it wouldn't work without every single bit of it. So to try and do it light or low fat doesn't really... they don't have the same outcomes, do they?
And one of the problems is that we serve the whole of the Northwest, but actually people come to our project for 4 days a week because it feels important that there's something they can attach to and feel a sense of belonging with. And with women, you don't have the same number of women in the same... So what you'd be doing is moving them away from their support systems, which is a challenge for us already, but we're not looking at such huge geographical areas.
Yeah. So you're going to be linked to the new prison, Bourbon? You're going to do any work with them?
I just noticed with your talk and with the previous talk as well, there's this talking about not getting drawn into firefighting and reenacting this kind of dance. Mm. And it's just making me wonder whether there's kind of a wider process going on. And in a sense, these kinds of services are enacting a dance.
Yeah.
I think they're superb services, but I just wonder at what point we step back and look at the patterns and think potentially there's something more fundamental, in the sense that you can do the firefighting, but fundamentally this is a problem with relating on the individual level. And on a societal level, we can keep on providing services for the people who've fallen foul of an unfair system. But is that just perpetuating eventually, the system where the upstream of where the problems are?
I think, did everybody hear that question? I think one of the really lovely things about CAT is that you can apply it kind of to two individuals, you can apply it to a service, you can apply it systemically, and then wider in the kind of socio-political context. And I think you're absolutely right that us as standalone services doing this at the moment is great. But instead, until politically, we learn to view every human as equal and everybody's kind of contribution to the world as dependent on far more than their financial contribution, then more widely we won't have a kind of compassionate relational approach to people who most need one. So yeah, I think you're right that really this needs change from a much wider kind of policy point of view, which is fantastic that Luciana's coming on in a minute to talk about kind of, you know, a more political agenda really. But yeah, I agree.
And we know early intervention works fantastically well, but it gets disinvested in. So this isn't instead of, I guess, our philosophy is nobody should be written off. But you're absolutely right, you know, intervening much earlier, preventative work would be, in an ideal world, we wouldn't exist, basically.
Okay, can I have a round of applause?